labors in the heat of the day. In glory and honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting and watching, in labors in the heat of the day. In glory and honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, as for me and my bounds, we will serve the Lord, serve the Lord.
Adore you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father. Father, you are so good. Father, we worship you. We praise you, Father. Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to the Almighty, the King of Kings, and the great I am, the way, the truth, the life, the door. We thank you, Father, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first, the last, the creator of all things. Oh, Father, we praise you. Almighty God, Almighty God, Almighty God, Almighty God, Almighty, 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 Almighty God, Almighty God. We worship you, Father. We praise you. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we surrender all to you. Tonight, Lord Jesus, we've come into this place, Father, together. Together as your church. Together, together as your church, Father, to worship you, to praise you, to glorify your name, Lord. To worship you, for you are worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy to be praised. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, Father, we've come here in unity to worship you and to seek you and to behold you and to see you and to receive of you and to go from glory to glory and to be filled, Father, with your presence. Till overflowing, Father, here's our cup, fill it up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, kereramaso bandele nemia shukorana sela tarre sedona no kurve shelana. Oh, praise you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Temo kurve shelana masata. You know what? This is the day that the Lord has made. This day right here is the day that he has made. He has made this day. And I will rejoice in it, be glad. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Because that's what he's asked me to do. And he's filled me up so much with his glory and with his presence and with his goodness and with his loving kindness and with his peace and his joy that I can rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because every good and perfect thing comes from God. Every day when we wake up, when we open our eyes, we look for what the good thing God is going to do. And then that way we don't get distracted on what the enemy might do to try to delure us and to try to get us caught up in the realms of self, which lead over into the realms of his stuff. But we're awake looking at what we wake up looking at what the Father has done. And we're rejoicing over what he has done. We're not looking at the circumstances, whether they're good or they're not, because it doesn't matter what they are, because God's word will never fail. And his word is, I am with you always, even unto the end of the earth. And if God is with us and God is for us, then who can be against us? Or what situation can be against us? What problem can be against us? Those things only come to perfect us, to make us more like him. When he's done his work in our heart, when he has said to us, when we receive the blood, the cleansing blood, the washing blood, the redeeming blood, the purifying blood, the blood that makes us holy, the blood that makes us pure, the blood that makes us righteous, the blood that completely finishes the work. He says it's finished in us. Hallelujah. Jesus. that exciting? His work is finished. He said it on the cross. It is finished. The work is done. And when we receive that atoning work in us, it's finished. It's done. He's given us of His Spirit. At that moment of redemption, it is finished. He has given to us all of heaven. It is ours. It belongs to us. We're immediately an heir with Jesus Christ the righteous. We're not working to a place of perfection to get to that place to where we can be an heir. Jesus did it for us. It is amazing to look at what Jesus did when He came. It is amazing to think about. The human understanding cannot even begin to comprehend what Jesus did when He left heaven to come to earth to redeem man. He came with so much love that man does not have a word to express the love that God came with and the completeness of redemption that He came to do for us, to bring us back into fellowship and back into relationship with the Almighty God. Instantly, the moment that we receive Him, the moment, He's not looking us over and sizing us up. That's man. You want to find where man is? Man's over there looking and sizing people up. Well, he didn't do so right. Let's just watch this guy. And if he walks along the path exactly like we think he should, then we will. Jesus instantly, the moment. And then He goes, "You're my beloved. You're my beloved and I am yours." Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Almighty God. We didn't do anything to deserve this. We could never do anything if we worked our life with everything that was in us to try to present ourselves good before God and do everything perfect. It would be nothing, because only that love that we receive from the Father enables us to love Him back. But never to the extent He loves us, though I want to. Amen. Because He is worthy. Amen. So worthy. He is so worthy. He is so worthy. He's so worthy. To look at that redeeming love. That there is no separation in His eyes. The only separation and the only condemnation comes from us listening to somebody that's a liar and the father of lies. There is no separation in Father's eyes. He only sees a holy, pure, righteous, redeemed saint that the Almighty God only could do. He only sees what the cleansing blood did. The cleansing blood. Woo! Jesus. Oh, there is no separation in Him. He's never looking at you beating you up. He's never one time looking at you going, You know, after Peter fell so miserably, Jesus told him, as soon as you're converted, and as soon as you've dealt with this, and you've got it under this atoning blood that is being paid for your redemption, go preach. Go preach the gospel. Go start the church, Peter. Strengthen the brethren. Get ready. The Holy Ghost is getting ready to be poured out. Prepare yourself to receive. All we do is prepare ourselves to receive by saying yes. And amazing. And then when Jesus showed up in that room where the disciples were sitting scared out of their mind, thinking that they were next, all of them were sitting there. They were hiding. They were hiding. They weren't bold out there going, bring it on. We're just going to go preach right behind Jesus, you know. They were all hiding. And Jesus didn't show up and beat them up and say, Peter, you bad little boy. I told you were going to do that. And I'm not too happy with you right now. You know, you really offended me. You said you're going to stick by me. You said you'd die with me, Peter, you loser. No. No, 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 no. The Lord Jesus was just there, appearing to him, his beloved ones, the ones that he had redeemed. When Peter was denying him, he goes, Peter, I'm going to die for you, and I'm going to shed my blood for you. And you're going to come to a fellowship of knowing me that goes far beyond any ability that man could ever do through the law. Because I'm going to cleanse this temple and I'm going to send the Holy Ghost and you're going to walk with me. I'm going to be revealed to you like you never comprehended. You saw these miracles. You walked with me. You performed these miracles. You did these things. You slept with me. You ate with me. You drank with me. And now it's going to be revealed to you by the Holy Ghost. Now it's going to come alive to you by the Holy Ghost. Now we're going to get the church started. And now the church is going to live victorious through the blood. It took the love of God to lay down his life and be nailed to that cross. Only the love of God could do that. No man could ever do that. No man could ever go through what Jesus went through. No man could ever bear the sins of the world. Some people have been tortured for Jesus, and some people have died in torture for other things, and all kinds of hideous things have been done to them, but no man could ever take upon themselves and bear the pain and the torture of the sins of the world like Jesus took on him. He bore what man can't comprehend in himself. He bore the sins. He felt the sin. He felt the shame. He felt every sin that was ever committed in his body. He bore it in himself. He took it on for me and you. And he suffered and he died and he bled to set us up on high forever with him. That love of God, that overwhelming love of God. It's so amazing. When I was asking the Lord, New Year's Eve, particularly, I've talked to the Lord a lot about what's going to go on this year and asking him to give me revelation and show me visions and dreams, and I want to know. I want to know what's going on. But I said, Lord, what are you saying? What are you saying to your church? 2017, and I know a lot of people got a lot of things. But one word, illuminated to me, and a word that I hadn't thought of in a long time in this form, and that word was agape. I was like, agape. And I was so captivated with agape and thinking about agape and going, I haven't thought about agape in a long time. We used to talk about agape, 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 but I haven't talked about agape in a long time. And I got so caught up on agape that I didn't stop to listen to anything else at that moment. But agape, I just overwhelmed at the Father speaking that to me. Because you know when the Father's saying something. So I've been looking at agape and just looking at the love of God. Does that surprise anybody? I'm like, Lord, I preach 95% on love. But I tell you what, if we can take a hold of that love, if we can comprehend, if we can perceive that love by the Spirit. See, it's only by the Spirit that we can understand it. But there's a pressing into to receiving what He's done, to actually taking a hold of it. And you know, I was ministering to one of the people I was ministering to this week. I had fun ministering to several people this week. It's been a good time ministering this week. Thank you, Jesus. But anyway, so one person I was talking to this week, you know, that has been going through a very trying time. And it seems like I've been telling this to a lot of people too. I'm like, a trial is not a trial unless it's trying. If it's not tough, if what you're going through is not a tough situation, then it's not a trying of your faith. Look, just be patient. God's working every perfect thing in you. So rejoice in the middle of it all. Rejoice in it. Rejoice. Rejoice. Rejoice right in the middle of it. Worship is the key. Worshiping the Lord, just coming into that worship of prayer and praise and rejoicing, is the way out. And so, you know, I'm ministering and the tough situations are going on, and you know, I'm praying for the breakthrough, and I'm like, come on, let's worship. Come on, let's rejoice. But it's bleak, it's bad. Ew, we're in the grind, we're falling apart, you know. The sky's falling. And I'm like, open your mouth and worship. Come on, let's get to worshiping. What does the word say? It doesn't matter what the situation says. It doesn't matter what the world says. It doesn't matter what it looks like. The word of God endures forever. And He said, rejoice. Rejoice. And so I'm just ministering to them. I'm like, you know, Father has given us all these things. Because they're like, why aren't we getting this healing? Why aren't we getting this now? Why isn't this happening now? Why don't we have the miracles like we had before? I'm like, let's not worry. And, you know, because they were talking about the church down the road. I said, let's not worry about the church down the road. Let's look at us right here, right now. I said, it's like the children of Israel. God said, all of that land is yours. I've given it to you. I will drive out the inhabitants. I will drive them out before you. Go up and possess it. I said, Jesus Christ paid for us to have everything of heaven. And He said, take it, it's yours. Amen. Amen. There's a resistance, though, that we find, don't we? He said, go take it, it's yours. I said, the children of Israel began to possess what God had given them. But the scripture says over and over again, they never fully possessed the land. They never fully possessed it. They never took all of their inheritance. They got cheated out of their inheritance. I'm like, now let's look at us. Let's look at you. Let's look at our situation. Do we want to stand before the Father one day and say, I didn't fully possess what was mine? No. Or do we want to fully possess it? Do we want to go up and take it? Do we want to go up? Do we want to say, God, you are able? Do we want to be like the Joshuas and the Calebs that said, I'm going up, and I'm possessing all that's mine? Amy and Brad named them Joshua and Caleb on purpose for that. They're going up. They're going to possess all that belongs to them. Amen. Do we want to be that? Yes. I said, so let's do it now. Yes. So we're possessing this. The sickness, the problem, the issue, and things looked bad. It looked bad. But it's not the truth. The Word of God is true.
Yes.
And what did He say? He promised. He promised. Thank you, Jesus. He promised that healing is our bread. And I began to go through Our Father, which art in heaven. Holy, holy, holy is Your name. First, we're recognizing Him. He's our Father. Then next, we're worshiping. We're worshiping. We began to worship. This is what Jesus taught His disciples to do. Worship. Recognize that God is your Father and that there is no separation between you and Him. He's Abba. He's Abba. He's Daddy God. He's Papa Father. He's close. He's right there. He's your dad. Thank you, Jesus. Holy is Your name. And next is real important. Your kingdom come, Your will be done. In earth, in this earthen vessel, Your will be done, Lord. Your will be done in earth, right here, in me. Because why? I surrender my will to You. I yield up my members to obey. I yield up my members as servants of obedience unto righteousness. Because You've given me righteousness, because You paid for this for me, I can yield myself now up to flow in Your righteousness and in Your truth. And I can live it all out in You and through You and by You, by Your Spirit. Through the Spirit, we live out the will of God. Give us this day our daily bread. Father, healing is the children's bread. I receive and I partake of my bread right now. Father, I thank You that I ask You to give me my bread. And when I ask You to give me my bread, You will not give me a stone.
Amen.
That is Your promise.
Amen.
Isn't it good? Oh, praise You, Jesus. His promise. His promises are sure. All we do is possess them and refuse to be denied. We refuse to allow anything to deny us from what belongs to us. It is mine. Many times people have used this reference of, if you know that you've been given an inheritance of $50 million in the bank and it's been deposited and you go to receive it, and there, you know, there's a whole list of things that they say you got to go through and do, and then they try to tell you it's not yours and it's not there and it's not for you. You're not going to take you're not going to go, okay, well, sure. Oh, oops. I asked once or twice and it just didn't work out. It's not working for me, so that $50 million, you know. I mean, the worst idiot on the planet's going to fight for it. The biggest loser, if you want to put yourself in that category. But you know what? You can't be a loser when you're heir and joint heir with Jesus Christ the righteous. And He's not letting go of you. He said, neither height nor depth or principality. Anything, nothing, nothing will separate you from the wonderful, glorious love, agape of God.
Yeah.
Nothing's going to separate you from Him. So when Father's looking at you, He's seeing His beloved, His redeemed child, His son, His daughter. He's seeing what Jesus paid for. Father is seeing the sacrifice that He made when He watched Jesus go through all that He suffered on earth from the moment He began in ministry all the way through. Well, from the moment He was born and from the time Satan tried to kill Him in the very beginning of His life all the way through till He died on the cross. What it cost Father, what it cost Jesus to buy you back. That's love. God paid a big price for you, and you don't think He's not going to fight for you. Don't think that He's going to just stop. because you got a little something, you know, some stuff wrong and you ain't doing it right. He's going to get in there and he's going to say, honey, come over here. Let me show you. Let me show you. Let me show you how much I love you. Come over here. Look how good this is. Look how good this is. And we open this up and we're just like, oh, Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Lord. And I look at it and sometimes and I'm like, why didn't I get this? Oh, Father. You know, and here's proof that you're a son and a daughter. Oh, Lord Jesus, I only want to please you. Oh, forgive me, I see where I've messed up. Oh, God, I made some blunders. Oh, Lord, that was a blunder. Oh, Father, forgive me. Forgive me. I don't want to do that. I don't want to walk that way. I don't want to do that. That's a child of God right there. That's a bought with the price child of God. Because that nature, the holy nature within you is saying, oh, God, I want to do it like you. And I thank you that your Holy Spirit opened my eyes so my eyes could see and my heart could hear. And I'm not looking at the past. I'm going to forget those things which are behind. I'm not going to go sit there and let the enemy beat me up, because God's not beating me up about those things. He's saying, you're my beloved and I am yours. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory to your name. It makes me want to shout and sing and rejoice. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. How can we do anything but get up in the morning and just worship and begin to praise Him and thank Him? You know, and as you do, then He begins to flood you. He begins to flood you with His goodness and with His love. And woo! It's just overwhelming. It's just glorious. It's so good. Oh, Jesus, we love you so much. You know, you just open your mouth and begin to praise. It puts the devil on the run. I teach this to my grandkids. I'm like, you just say, thank you, Lord Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I'm going to serve you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. And I go anytime the enemy's trying to make you afraid or scared or whatever he's trying to do against you. You just say, Jesus. And he has to turn around and run. He doesn't like the name above all names, especially when you're applying it to you. I said, just lift up the name. You just worship Jesus. You just thank you, Jesus. And I'm like, every lying thing has to take off and run. Whoo, it's good. It's so good. Whoo, thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Father. God, you're so good. I just want to share a little bit, I think, if the Holy Spirit will allow me to, I want to share a little bit about agape, what the Lord spoke to me. And just, you know, in me studying and looking at agape, if I can at all see this, because I put it in here too tiny for me to see, I think. Well, we'll try. It is a love of esteem, of elevation. It has the idea of prizing. It is the noblest word for love in the Greek language. There's four Greek words that speak of love in the Greek language. And understanding that the New Testament was written in Greek, that's why we're looking at the Greek. Just in case there's anybody that doesn't know, there's some young people in here. It delights in giving. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. It's not kindled by the merit of worth of its object, but it originates its own God-given nature because God is love. I don't think agape in the Greek word can even come close to expressing. I don't think there's a word that could be written that could express the love of God. I think the love of God can only be experienced by the Spirit. There is no way to comprehend the love of God except to experience the love of God. I'm experiencing the love of God, but I know it's vast. And I know that by the Spirit, it's going to get bigger and deeper and wider, broader. Oh, Jesus. But I know this, it's good.
Yes.
It's good. I could read this and it just kind of go over your heads, but if you by the Spirit receive, there's some impartation here. There's some things here that are written that may bring some connection of understanding and you receiving through the Spirit, by the Spirit. We got everything we do has got to be by the Spirit.
Amen.
Or it's of no effect. If you think you're going to walk out this life with God without the Spirit, you're sadly mistaken. Jesus came to cleanse the temple so he could go to the Father and the Father could send the Holy Ghost to lead us and guide us in all truth. And the evidence the Holy Ghost came was there was fire and there were tongues of fire.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. A mighty wind brought the tongues of fire. And that's the spirit realm that takes us out of all intellect and over into the spiritual. And it's the beginning, it's the start of going deep into the things of God. And it all operates by love. Everything in God operates by love. Jesus was moved with compassion for the people. And out of the compassion, out of the agape, out of the realms of God, the only way that, the greatest way that the Greeks could express it, agape, out of that compassion of God, he healed everyone that was around. He began to heal, show forth the love he freely gave. He didn't come up to you and say, I know what you was doing yesterday. Bad, 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 bad girl. You ain't getting any. Next. And he knew what all of them had done. And we know man left to himself with just the law isn't doing too well. And he healed all of them. He healed all of them. He reached down to the woman and adult that was caught in adultery that by law should have been stoned. He reached down to her. And after all the accusers left, he said, neither do I condemn you. Look at Father picking you up like that. Neither do I condemn you. I give you power. Go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Jesus. My Jesus.
Yes.
My God.
Yes.
This love. This love. This overwhelming love. I don't normally try to read anything, but this was just so powerful to me in reading this. There are only a few known occurrences of this word, love, outside of the Bible. Isn't that amazing? In other words, this word was not used very often in extra-biblical writings, only used in the Word of God. So it is a powerful form of love that they came up with to express the agape of God. And I mean, we can look in 1 Corinthians and chapter 13 and go through there and explode on how the love of God is. But 1 John is powerful. And then John 13:14, going in there, the agape of God. Maybe we'll get over there and we'll feast a little bit at the table. It desires only the good of the one loved. It is a consuming passion for the well-being of others. A consuming passion for the well-being of others. It is a love that loves without changing. It is a self-giving love that gives without demanding or expecting repayment. It is love so great that it can be given to the unlovable or the unappealing, the undeserving, the unworthy. It is a love that loves even when it is rejected again and again and again. It loves anyway. Isn't that amazing? How many times do people reject Jesus before they receive him? And you know what? I am convinced that people live a very long time sometimes because God, you know, they outlive Christian people. Christian people, they go on home earlier and, you know, I've known people living into their 90s and even hitting right at 100. And I think, oh God, you know, they should have been dead. I know the situation of this person. They should have been dead when they were in their 50s and 60s because the life that they lived, I mean, even the doctor said you're not going to make it because of the life that they lived. And then live into their 90s and even 100 because God was just like, come to me, receive me. He was just pleading and just that hope. He would that all men come to him. And God is just that merciful. He's that good. He's that loving. And you think he's going to give up on you? You think he's mad at you? You think he's going to beat you up because you messed up at some point? No. He wants you to get it right. He might bring some discipline, but that's love. When we spank our kids, do we hate them? No. And there's times, you know, I wanted to really whack them good. Now get this time. And to think about it, would a father done it exactly like I was thinking? Did I really have agape in the whole picture of the thing? Did I make sure that they understood? Were they being defiantly rebellious and worthy of a spanking? Were they being totally defiant? Or did they need parental direction? Because, I mean, I was sergeant, and it was my way or the highway. It is love that loves even when it is rejected. Agape love gives and loves because it wants to. It does not demand or expect repayment from the love given. That doesn't sound like man or the Adam nature, does it? It sounds like the God nature. Yeah. It gives because it loves. It does not love in order to receive. And then, yeah, I'm going to let that go. But to look at the other Greek definitions of love kind of brings you along a little bit in understanding agape, I think, in a deeper way. And there's the storge love, and that's the family love. And that's almost a natural love. If you're a normal human being, I know that there are people that they're so far from God and so taken over by the enemy that they don't even have the natural love of a parent for their children. But anybody that's not taken over by Satan to that point, you know, you naturally love your child. You naturally love your family. It's, you know, natural love for a husband or a wife or an animal. It's abiding. No, putting an animal along with husband and wife. That's funny. But, you know, the husband and wife would be a little bit deeper, but I would think, and the child. But people get real attached to their animals. I mean, it's pretty crazy. It's pretty crazy how they get attached to their animals. I mean, they call them their children and everything else, so. I mean, that's weird to me. You know, I was raised like farm type, you know. The animals were on the farm to do their work, and when it was time to eat them, you ate them. Except for the dog or the cat, you know. Everything else, you know. If you name the chicken or you name the cow or you name the pig, you know, Albert was going to be on the table at some point. But, you know, I think probably... Actually, I would put, this is somebody's opinion, and I would put I'd put the dog love over here in phileo, the phileo type of love for a friend, the love for a friend, the love that speaks of affection, fondness, or liking. That's where the dog one belonged, not over here. Sorry about that. I didn't write this, but I'm reading it, and I'm gleaning from the different things, and you know, and I'm taking from those that are those that study the word and not from the world's perspective, and just looking at it. Pastor Mark, he'll come and he'll, if he listens to this, he'll come and he'll straighten us all out in a deeper understanding of everything. But this is and then the fourth one is eros. This love right here is the one that I think should be called era. But it's a love, and you know, very, I would put it as like in 2 Samuel 13:1, where Amnon, was that his name, Amnon? Had the love for his sister Tamar, Absalom's sister. Very selfish. It's all about self. It's all about, oh, I'm in love with her because she's beautiful. Oh, I'm in love with him. He's so tall. Look at that guy, tall, dark, handsome. He does everything right. I like how he acts. I like what he does. It's all self-gratification. And see, that's the love that people fall into and they fall out of. I love you, and now you're not, you know, you kind of got a little bit ugly. You got a little fat, and you don't look so great anymore. And, you know, now that I really get to know you after living with you, you're not exactly what I thought, so later. And it has nothing to do with the love of God that, out of all of these Greek words, we're supposed to flow in with our husband and our wife. You know, so we can't, you know, we're talking about the natural people that don't haven't experienced the things of the Spirit, that they have these kind of loves operating. But the love of God, the agape, it has no selfishness in it. It's a love that goes beyond the limit, that love that goes to the extreme, a love that goes to where man would never go, a love that has nothing about self. And that's the love that God told us to love our brother with, much more to love our husband and our wives and our children. And there's so many scriptures that we can compare all of that with and look at that, about that love that God wants us to live in because he's given it to us. And I think we're gonna look over here just a little bit. But being able to look and compare these loves, I mean, to me, you know, looking at it, I was just like, oh, it's just amazing how people are stuck in the human realm. And how great God's love is, and how when we receive the love of God, how we are able to go and exhibit an unconditional love. Unconditional love is something that people don't comprehend. When people do evil to you, do wrong to you, you turn and you love anyway. You turn and you're good and you're kind. This is Father. This is Father. I was talking to ministering to someone just recently, and they were telling me about how that they didn't talk to this certain person that was actually a family member any longer because of what they said. And I get that, you know, what they said and what they did, it was mostly what they did, and then what they said over what they did made what they did even worse than what they said, you know, because now that they said was, you know, more than what this person could bear. And yeah, as a human, yeah, yeah. But are we saints of God? Yes. Do we belong to him? Yes. You know, and you know, and I could get the pain, and it was like sticking a sword through their heart to that person. You know, and I said, you know, basically a trial, again, a trial is not a trial unless it's tough. And I said, but Father has called us to forgive and to love. Amen. And I said, I am so thankful, so very thankful that God's talking to me. And he's not shutting me out because I have done things that would offend the Father. But he's not offended because he loves. Because offense can't comprehend agape. God's not offended. God doesn't get offended at us, his children. But I've done things that would offend him. I've done things that would have hurt him, but he's still talking to me. And I said, more than that, he still loves me. And he wants us to be just like him. He called us to be. He said, if we say that we belong to him, that we should walk even as he walked. Amen. And he's called us to be partaker of such amazing love that it absolutely blows away human ability. The love of God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Turn to Corinthians. We're going to look at this just a little bit. I mean, not Corinthians. I was thinking Colossians, but then I'm thinking of Ephesians. Well, we could go through so many scriptures on it. Ephesians 3 and 4 are just so rich in the love of God. And we'll stop over here in 5, verse 2. But walk in love, walk in agape, as Christ has agaped us and has given himself for us an offering, a sacrifice, for a sweet-smelling Savior. Walk in agape as Christ has sacrificed himself for us. Walk in that same sacrifice. See, and that's agape. It's a sacrificial love. It's a love that goes beyond anything that is ever deserved. It gives what is not deserved. It gives what is not deserved. So it won't be offended. It won't be hurt. It won't turn away. It won't look at you and put you on the black list and you on the blue list and you on the white list and you on the green list. It won't put you on a list. It puts you in one category. Love! Because if we don't watch it, we'll line people up on a list. And we'll prefer some over another. And then we become judges of the heart and the thoughts and the intent. We put ourselves above God when we list people. Jesus. Isn't that amazing? See, the agape, we talked about the love for the family and for our children and for the husband and the wife. And that's a natural love that's there. But agape goes so far beyond it, and God tells us to agape everyone. And it goes so far beyond what we can have for a family member. So now we'll go over into Colossians. We'll start with verse 12. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God... He just called you his elect. Elect. You're on the only list. You're on his elect list. And he's saying, by the Holy Spirit, through the Spirit, this is what I've done for you, and this is how to walk it out. He gave us these letters so we could see how to walk it out, and so they could explode on the inside of us by the Spirit so we could live it out. It's written on our heart. You know, we have to put our finger here and we have to go to Jeremiah 31. Because this is what Jesus did when he came. Just get this, 31:31. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant, the new covenant. I will make a new covenant. What are we living in?
New covenant.
I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the days that I took them by the hand and to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, says the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel, with us, after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their inward parts, and I will write it in their heart, and will be their God, and they shall be my people, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. Thank you, Jesus. He has cast our sins as far as the east is from the west. He's given us a new covenant, a covenant of blood, a covenant of love, a covenant of relationship, a covenant of fellowship, a covenant of union. A covenant of union. God doesn't break covenant. A covenant that he is in us and we are in him. When we have that love, when we've received that love, he comes and he makes his abode in us. And we know that we have that love. The test is that we keep his commandments, and we keep his commandments because he loved us so much and he gave us the ability to through this new covenant. And we find this right again right over here in 1 John. You said that was the Old Testament, so I got to bring us over here into the New Testament. He has fulfilled in us the promises of the new covenant. And he is fulfilling in us the promises of the new covenant. All the way till the trumpet sounds. And the dead in Christ rise first. And then we, which are left, go right up after them when this mortal puts on immortality. And we meet him in the air, in the clouds. I know a lot of people have left the rapture of the church, and they're like, you know, people are sitting around on their thumbs doing nothing in God, waiting on the rapture of the church, so we're not going to have the rapture of the church anymore. And there's some people that have even done away with the book of Revelation, say it's already happened in the past, and it's not going to happen anymore. It's not in the new... there's a lot of kind of crazy doctrine going on out there. That's why you got to know the word, and thank God we sit under a preacher that knows the word, and then, you know, we can hold these things in. So, you know, if God sends us out and about ministering, you know, and people bring us all these doctrines, and look, they're going to look good. They're going to have signs and wonders too. The devil's always copying Jesus. He's always copying the Father. He's always making things look, trying to look like God. He's a big fat copycat. But there's all lies all around it. It's built on sand. It's not built upon the rock. Amen. It's built on ground that when the wolf huffs and puffs, is going to blow it all down. When the wind of the Spirit moves, it crumbles. Thank you, Jesus. That's what I should say. But 1 John chapter 2, verse 20. But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. Who does? Who knows all things? We do. Because we have an unction. The Holy Ghost. Where he's come to abide and live in us. So we know all things. All we have to do is ask. Isn't it amazing what God will tell us when we ask? We ask and he reveals his word to us. And isn't it amazing that it's always his word that he reveals? If you feel like you got a revelation that's not in the word, scratch that one. Say, oh Lord, teach me to hear your word. We don't hear the voice of another. But sometimes people get real zealous and excited and they almost try to make up something. But that's okay if they just get over here to the Word and stick with the Word. And you know, the Bible says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. My dad used to always say, so if you can rightly divide the word of truth, that means you can wrongly divide the word of truth. So you need to rightly divide the word of truth. So that's why you need to study and you need to know. So when Pastor Mark says it, you can't go, yeah, that's true, that's true. Because everybody knows from school that if you study and you take the test yourself, that you now comprehend a whole lot more than what you did when the teacher was just talking from standing up in front. When you dug into it and you had to know it and you had to write the thing on the test because the teacher wasn't up there talking about it anymore, you know. You know more. And that's and we got the Holy Ghost that helps us study, that brings all things to our remembrance as we put it in. You know, people go, Lord, bring everything to my remembrance right now. Well, they never even put it in their memory. And how's he going to bring it to the remembrance if they don't put it in? You got to put it in there. But I tell you what, I am saying, Lord, as I read your word, I'm just like, you know, because in the natural, if I want to look over the natural man, sometimes I have a more of a challenge in memorizing certain things and remembering where they are. You know, not that the word isn't in me, but just remembering where they are can be very challenging for me sometimes. I'm like, it's all my DNA, Father. Right, and Lord, as I read it, as I, Father, just stamp it all over me. You know, it's written in my heart. Yeah. You know, even where it's at. I think Matthew wrote Matthew straight and didn't even put the verses in everything in. But anyway, that was put so we could find it easier. I have not written unto you because you know not the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. I'm trying to get down here to verse 27. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. This is all good too. He that acknowledgeth the Son hath the Father also. Let that therefore abide in you, which you have heard from the beginning. If that which you have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, you also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he hath promised us, even eternal life. These things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you, but the anointing which you have received of him abides, lives, dwells on the inside of you, in you, and you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you of all things and is true and is no lie, even as it hath taught you, you shall abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. This anointing abides in you. And, you hear something. You may hear something from another preacher, be in another church, or be, you know, somewhere, or you know, turn somebody on the YouTube on, and you hear something, and you haven't heard it before. And all of a sudden, you know, you feel like a grieving in your spirit. Like, you know, that's not right. That's the Holy Spirit going, go over here to the Word. Go over here. Fortify yourself in the Word. Know what the Word of God says. Hear the Word. The Holy Spirit will keep you if you will let Him. But you can also run over top of Him, and then you can get into a bunch of stuff. And God's children get into a bunch of stuff. They do. And then the Lord's so merciful. He works with them to bring them out. His heart is to bring them out of the stuff and bring them over into the truth of the Word. But we have this anointing. If we will abide in Him, He will lead us and guide us in all truth by His Spirit. Now we can go back to Colossians. Thank you, Jesus. Above all things, we're just going to get up here. Well, I'm put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. And basically, it's just saying who you are. who you are in God, what He has done in you, what Jesus has done in you, who He is and what He has done in you, so you can live it out. He will perfect these things in you. Long-suffering, forbearing one another, forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. Jesus forgave you. Did you deserve it? You were His enemy. He forgave you, but you didn't deserve it. You were serving His enemy. You were living for His enemy. You were dead in your sins and your trespasses. You were doing evil, wicked things against Him. You did not deserve it. And when you didn't deserve it, He forgave you, and He expects us to forgive.
Yeah.
Just like that. Because He's in us. That's why. That's why we can put these things on. That's why we can live it out. That's why we can yield ourselves unto Him. And let righteousness reign and rule in us. And do righteousness. Because that's when you know that it's a servant of God versus a servant of the enemy. And Romans chapter 6 will take you through that. Thank you, Jesus. And above all things, and above everything that you do, and above all things. And really, this is what will work everything in you when you yield yourself to Agape. When you yield yourself to the work that He did in you. He did His agape for you and in you. For you and in you.
Amen.
For you and in you.
Yes.
He came and He took on everything. And He made you holy. He made you unreprovable. He made you unblameable. In His sight, He is presenting the church without spot or wrinkle. He is doing it. He has done it. He's already done it in you. It's already finished in you. The work is already done. And if you allow Him, if you will continue on to know the Lord and walk with Him, He will perfect everything in you as you yield yourself to Him. And let the and above all things, put on agape, which is the bond of perfection. Right there. Right there. You put on love, and you love everybody that doesn't deserve it. If there's somebody, you know what? If there's somebody that has offended you, and you don't talk to them anymore, or if there's somebody you know that could be wounded or hurt or whatever, and you haven't talked to them, and you knew them, and you talked to them, and it could be a family member. You need to call them up, and you need to practice some agape. You need to say, hey, look, I'd like to have lunch with you. I'd like to treat you to lunch. Wasn't your birthday a couple of months ago or something, and I missed it? I mean, come up with something. Hey, and I'm not telling you anything that I haven't practiced. Because the Lord's been working some extra agape in me over the last few years while I've been preaching it. You guys are probably just sitting here listening to what I'm preaching to me. But I tell you what, it's been a good season of me preaching on agape for how long. And this year I want to see perfection.
Amen.
Me.
Amen.
Me. Me. I want to know and I want to comprehend His love. I want to receive all of His love.
Amen.
And I want to give His love.
Amen.
I want to give His love. You know, I'm going to share just a little something with you. You know, I don't want to try to say this in any offended way, but, you know, my husband's like, you know, been for years going, I want to go to India. Let's go to India. Let's go minister to people in India. I said, baby, you know, on that one, I tell you what, I'll pray and you go. Because I just don't really have any desire to go to India. That just, you know, doesn't give me, I don't like to travel anyway. You know, I know people like to go and they like to see all the sights and take it all in. I'm like, either I'll wait till I can get translated from place to place, or I'll just wait till, you know, Jesus comes and then He can show me all around. I mean, I'm just like, people get excited about that kind of stuff. I'm just not too worried about it. I mean, that's just, you know, whatever. But, you know, India wouldn't be the top one on my list. But you know, it's amazing that not long after that, God started putting India on my heart. And, you know, and then I started ministering to more people, Hindu people and people from India. And then it just, it keeps pressing in to where more, to Father just leads me, okay, Father, give me more authority over the Hindu people when I speak to them, Father, in Jesus' name. And, you know, and I just kind of find myself captivated about, you know, okay, Father, how do you want to speak through me? And, you know, I'm pressing in to take a hold of it. Isn't that amazing how God changes you from who you are?
Yeah.
From who you think you are?
Yeah.
To be who He has destined you to be?
Yeah.
I mean, that's just a little thing, but, you know, that's something that, you know, He takes you from something that you just go, eh. I'll pray. You go. I'll stay here. That's quite all right. To, you know, it's amazing. And I didn't like any of the food, and I love it. And I, you know, I used to wouldn't touch any of that kind of stuff. But isn't that amazing how God is?
Yes.
He's like, I'm going to take you right where you thought you didn't want to go. And I'm going to show you agape. it's so good. It's so transforming. It's so amazing. It makes you comprehend that glory to glory. Oh, Father. Oh, Father. The bond of perfection. The bond of perfection. To be like Jesus. That's all I want, is to be like Him. To be like Jesus. And He's done it for me. He finished it. He said, it's finished. It's finished. You are like me. And you know what? You're going to stand up before the Father and you're going to receive my same inheritance. I'm overwhelmed at His love continually. And let the peace of God rule your hearts. Boy, that right there is a tough thing to receive. And let the peace of God rule your hearts. It's not tough to receive. What a burden. Peace. Oh. To which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom and teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. So you got somebody, you know somebody that needs, that hadn't been doing it right, that's over here on that, you know, green list, blue list, whatever, black list. I hate to say black list. We don't want to put nobody on the black list. I mean, you know, we're Christians. We don't put anybody on the black list. We only put them on the green list. Well, and put them on the list of, you know, I'm not going to talk to them right now, you know, because there's some people you need to avoid. I think we just went over here to the error one. The error love, the Greek one for, you know, the love that fails, the failing love. Father's good. He wants us to get up there to those people that we would put on the green list and encourage them with songs and hymns and spiritual songs. Singing with grace in your heart in the Lord. And whatsoever you do, and whatever you do, and whatsoever you do, whatever you do, everything that you do, do everything, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God, the Father, and the Father by Him. Everything that you do, everything that you do, do it as unto the Lord. Right down here, it skips right down and says in verse 23, and whatever you do, do it heartily as if you were doing it, as if Jesus was standing right there.
Yeah.
And you are doing it to Him. If you've done it unto the least of these, my brethren, The least. That means the most obnoxious one. I think Father reaches out to the most obnoxious one more than he does anyone else. Because that's love. It goes beyond the limits because he's God and because he cares as much as for that one as he does for any. Because he says he would that all come to him. And when you're his elect, how much more? We need to treat each other. I think we should start greeting each other. Hello, elect of God. You know, if we would prophesy and speak it out of our mouth. Hello, saint of God, elect. My dearly elect friend. My dearly elect husband, saint of the Most High God. We might have a different way that we speak the rest of the words. Maybe we should do that continually instead of saying their name. Hi, elect saint of God. There'd be a change. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, how he loves me and you. And you know, I have to say me, because if I don't receive how much he loves me, then I can't ever love you. If I can't receive that God loves me, then I'm going to be hiding like Adam and Eve in shame. I'm always going to be hiding from God if I don't receive his love. I'm always going to be like far off from him. I'm always going to feel like I'm the one that just never got it. You wouldn't believe how many people in counseling and stuff and ministering to them feel like, you know, well, maybe I'm Judas. Or, you know, I blasphemed. You know, God is so much bigger than any of the enemy's tactics. His stinking lies that he tries to force upon people. You know, you think of a child, and, you know, this is kind of like an analogy maybe that I don't really want to use, but you think of a child. If a child, okay, so like this, you know, our kids see us with cell phones and our grandkids see us with cell phones, right? And so what they see you with, they want, right? They want to do what you do. Your kids mimic you. They want to do what you do. And if you do it, then they're going to want to do it even more than what you do because, I mean, if you've got that thing in your hand, it must be fun. It must be good. It must be something to do. So you see that even the little babies, you see the babies that don't know a thing about what that is, they want it. And they're, you know, and they're like, give it to me, give it to me, give it to me. And they don't say give it to me. They're just like, ah, 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 ah. And you're just like, no, no, no. And you could teach them, no, that's not yours. You're not having it. And that will end it. But just go and give them that thing. One time. Especially when they went, ah, give it to them. And then the next time they see the phone, they're going to go, ah, and you'll be on it with an important business call or something, and they're like, ah, and you're trying to run from your toddler, which is chasing you around screaming for the phone because you gave it to them last time. And they're relentless. And, you know, the parent's just like, ah, here, you know, whatever, hold it, you know. They try to appease the screaming. You dummy. You just taught them to do it again. You just trained them to scream for it again. And they won't stop. And it's just like that with the enemy. And I, you know, I really don't like to compare one of our precious children with the enemy. But it's like that with the enemy. If you give the enemy 1 inch, he thinks he has that territory and he possesses it. And he'll come along, but he's worse. Like, he tries to just take your head and just shove your face into it and force you towards things. I mean, he'll put it up everywhere and, you know, whatever, make you run into that situation like a wounded person. A wounded person that has received a wound. If you don't get rid of that, you will run into wound after wound after wound after wound. There will be a wound popped up. There will be Mr. Wound and Mrs. Wound and little wound and big wound and, you know. there will be wound. And you will be wounded, 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 and you'll be just carrying the wounds of the world. Because you gave into the first wound. It's just like that with sin. That sin, but you're like, you don't understand. I didn't do anything. Oh, get off your holier-than-thou pedestal and get down and repent for allowing a wound. Because that's not agape. Agape wouldn't get a wound because it can't be offended. Because it loves, it goes beyond the limits. It goes beyond the rejection. It goes beyond the hurt. It goes beyond even people being brutal. That's where, you know, you can hear the people, you know, because this is wound that goes beyond what we comprehend, but people that have been tortured for Jesus. And they turn and they say, God loves you. And he's calling you. And I love you. And I just want to give you the gospel. And the guy standing there, I just beat you to no end. I just tortured you. I just electrocuted you. And you're loving me? That is agape.
Yeah.
That is the love of God being expressed through man. How much more should we love one another?
Yes.
And not be offended by each other? It be as though it never happened and go beyond and be like God, which God is continually going, oh, no, no, hon, over here. This is where it's at. Over here, this is what's good. Get away from the stove. Don't put your hand on the burner. It's hot. I'm around a lot of little kids. Ones that can reach up and touch things that don't know what they're going to touch. And you're just going, not good for you, dear. Come over here. No, no, don't touch it. You know, get something a little warm enough that they're going to pull back from so you can go hot. So hot makes a connection. Father's always going, hot, hon, over here. He's not, you put your hand up there. Just come on, put your hand up there. Let me just stick it in that fire a little bit and toast your finger a little. What daddy would do that loves? Father's not doing that. But that's how we display God, sadly, so many times as his people to each other. In the, but we go, you know, I'm biting my tongue. I'm so saintly. I'm biting it now. No, that's not agape. I might be talking to some of the kids here that, you know, are just learning, young people or something. Jesus. The goodness of God. He's so amazing. But, you know, he's so real and he's so down to where we live, saying, come over here. Come over here because I want you operating in the compassions of Jesus where you're not offended by having the revelation and the word of knowledge and knowing what all of these people have done. And so you're not stopped by what they have done and who they are and the mistake and the mess up they are. But you can reach out and you can extend the compassions of Jesus and you can turn aside and heal them all and bring them all to me through the signs and the wonders and the miracles. Show forth the glory because you've learned to walk in this agape, this a compassion of Jesus.
Amen.
Outside of it, faith doesn't work. We get a little miracle here and there, but we're not walking in that greater works ministry because we have added to the gospel in our action. We want to cut all of the adding off.
Yes.
And we want to look and be agape and become agape. We want to become love. We want to be those that are totally given over to what he has done in us. And through the Spirit, see the mind of the Spirit. And therefore, allow the Spirit to work in us. So his glory can be seen throughout the nations of the earth. And that is what it's all about. That's why he's working in us. This work. So we can be those co-laborers and do the greater works ministry.
Amen.
We haven't gotten to the place. I haven't known anyone that's gotten to the place that's doing the works of Jesus yet. Father, I want to go there.
Amen.
And I know I'm seeing the keys. I'm seeing the things. Lord, you're breaking down the things that I've allowed in my life to be added to me that weren't a part of what you did in the redemptive plan.
Amen.
I've taken on things that don't belong to what you've done in the redemptive plan, and I haven't been that agape. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you open my eyes, that I can see.
Yes.
That I can be all that you've called me to be. I can live it and walk it out. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we can press in to see the glory of God revealed in the earth today.
Yes.
This is what he's saying.
Yes.
He's saying, come up. Come up and follow me and be like me. So you can show forth my glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we're on that path, and that's where we're going.
Amen.
And Father's just revealing to us things that will get in the way, the obstacles that will get in the way, the hindrances that will get in the way. And, you know, and I like what, just a minute, and I'll get his name. Attaboy. Brother Attaboy said, when he talked about, he goes, anytime you have a great victory is the time to go into fasting and praying.
Yeah.
That's the time to go. And I looked at it so many times of where there's been great victories where God did miracles through me, or there was an outpouring, or you know, something happened that God used me to bring people to salvation. Whatever it was that God used me in, you know, in ministry, whatever it was, that there was a breakthrough that hindered the enemy's territory, made the enemy take his hands off, there would be a battle afterwards. And I'm like, that is it, man. That is so true. That's when you go into, oh, God, thank you, Jesus, that you could use me. Now, Father, strengthen me by your Spirit to use me more. And you really go into seeking him. And then that's where it can be expressed more, because in that, the enemy will try to put you on the run. He'll try to scare you. He'll try to push you back. He'll try to intimidate you. He'll try to do all kinds of things. And you can look at the history of the men that have gone, and men and women that have gone before us, and the detours that the enemy tried to set up for them. You know, I don't want to talk about them, because one time I spoke out something about a man of God that, you know, I understood in a book that, you know, went, you know, through reading a book of his history and of his life, that went in a detour and went in the wrong direction, and bad things, you know, happened in his life. And I spoke it out and called his name, and then the Lord got on to me good, because I did it in public. He goes, were you there? Did you see it? I said, no, sir, Father. He goes, then don't you talk about it anymore. And I said, yes, sir, Lord. So I'm saying no names about anything, but there's those that you can look at and you can say, okay, Father, I want those keys. Attaboy's got some keys here of protecting yourself in the things of the Spirit, that you go deeper in the realms of God. You're doing things in the kingdom. You get, you know, Amy and Brad, they're going out continually every week on the streets, knocking on doors, ministering to these people over here in these, you know, housing developments. You know, not only do they want to, you know, spend time in praying before and after, but we want to pray for them. And everyone that's going out on the streets, at Sandy and what she's doing, and when Kate and Ruth go out once a month, I mean, we want to pray for them. I mean, it's prayer that it takes the atmosphere and captivates the atmosphere and pulls down the strongholds and removes the things that the enemy would try to do to hinder. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. And those are the things that we should be focused on. If we're so busy in the kingdom, we won't have time to be caught off on the other foolishness. It changes things all around when you just get so focused on the things of the kingdom and the things of God, and you find yourself, what was I doing, and what was the problem, and where, you know, and I've told people that, you know, came with a list of problems. I said, look, let me help you. Get so busy in the kingdom doing things for God, you won't have time for all this nonsense.
Amen.
You won't have time to sit and think about it. One of your biggest problems, you've got too much time on your hands to sit and think about it. Here, let me give you a toilet brush. Get started. If you don't know where to get started, hey, we can help you get started somewhere. And there's a lot to do around here. And yes, it's ministry. It'll teach you how to get into thanksgiving and worship and praise. Do everything that we do. All of it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. As if we were doing it to him if he was standing there. And how many would clean Jesus' bathroom? Amen. We are. We are. When we clean the restroom, that's what we're doing. It's Jesus' bathroom. Because it's the house of God. We're doing it for him. Everything we do. Praise you, Lord Jesus. It's all about we're pressing in to see the glory of God revealed in such a powerful way. See, we come together in the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. We come with one focus and one mind together to encourage and lift one another up, exhort one another, not go, oh, you're down there, leaving you over here for right now. No, we're bringing them along. We're pulling them along. We're coming together in the spirit of unity and the bond of peace. We're coming along to press in, to push forward the things of the kingdom, because when there's unity and there's nothing hindering, when we love, when we have this agape flowing in us, in this unity, we're going to see the glory of God, and they'll come from the east, the west, the north, the south, to hear the thunders and the sound of heaven and the glory of heaven that is revealed in the place. Because every single time somebody comes for a miracle, they receive a miracle. Every single time that somebody needs something, every single time that somebody walks in and is in need of God, their mail is read, and they say, surely the presence of God is in this place, and they fall down upon their face. And this is what God is calling us to as a body. Amen. And we thank you, Jesus, for a people that will press in. And everybody in this place are those people to press in. I don't see anybody that is left out. And we thank you, Jesus, for a people that stand up, stand up, stand up, and receive and take a hold of and possess all that Father has for us. We thank you, Jesus, if you'll stand with me. Let's just come together and let's just thank Father for what he's done. Thank him for what he's working on the inside of us, and believe and receive all that he has, and press in for the signs and the wonders and the miracles. Cry out to God for the moving of his Spirit, that the lost can hear a church, a redeemed church, a church of Jesus Christ that's living in the works of Jesus Christ and greater works. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Zebe korbe shenanala. Bela namaso. Bela namaso te. Tenena makera. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we thank you for the glory. We thank you for the glory of you revealed. Father, we thank you for the outpouring of your Spirit. We thank you, Father, for the work, the finished work that you have done in us, Father God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your people, Father, don't get caught up in the cares and the riches and the pleasures and the things of this world. Father, that we not allow ourselves to get distracted. Father God, we don't allow anything, Father, that would try to detour us away from, Father, the movings of the Spirit. But Father, we thank you for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost and fire. Lord Jesus, with a pure heart and a true heart. Father God, we reach out and we seek you, Father, with our whole heart, with everything that is within us. Father, we hold nothing back.